Even his third quartet, Opus 30, which is a highly serial work, opens with repeated four-bar phrase groups that aren't really very far from the procedures of Mozart. See if I can play this. You need four hands to play a quartet, but anyway. I knew I'd ruin it. But anyway, do you get the idea of the four-bar symmetrical structures, then repeated, making eight bars? And it's even tonal sounding. Repeated eight times. It's almost as though you had E minor and the dominant of E minor. Now, of course, that's ruining the music, but I've just tried to show you the implications of tonality that are so strong. Eight times in a row. And even in Opus 31, the orchestral variations, a work rarely played because of its difficulty for performers and listeners alike, even here, we find sequences such as this. What could be more symmetrical? And that's symmetrical both tonally and structurally. Left hand, right hand, clear as day. And such examples abound throughout the corpus of Schoenberg's work. In fact, as late as 1944, in the last decade of his life, he wrote an entire work in G minor, key, signature, and all. Would you believe that this is by the same composer whose dodecaphonic system we've been discussing? There's a famous quote from Schoenberg in which he says, "A longing to return to the older style was always vigorous in me, and from time to time I had to yield to that urge." He then went on to say that that's why he has written so much tonal music, even late in life, and then dismissed the whole problem by saying that these stylistic differences, as he called them, aren't really very important. Imagine, after having spent most of his life tearing the world apart, turning everything up on its ears by denying tonality, then to come out and say, well, that's what I mean by the great thinkers of the world. They are always contradicting themselves. Of course, there are those who say that Schoenberg wrote this tonal piece out of desperation to have his music publicly performed. And indeed, this theme and variations in G minor was given its premiere performance by the Boston Symphony under Koussevitzky, who rarely, if ever, played 12-tone music by Schoenberg or anyone else. If the story is true, then it's a heartbreaking story, because far from connoting anything deprecatory or anything to impugn Schoenberg's integrity, it rather illustrates the pitiful situation of an unplayed master, 70 years old, at that time, most of whose major works were yet to be performed by most of our major orchestras, and that includes the great violin concerto, the piano concerto, and the five pieces for orchestra, which may well be his orchestral masterpiece, to say nothing of Opus 31 variations. But in whatever sense that story is true, it cannot detract from the evident truth of Schoenberg's continuing rocky romance with tonality, right up to his death in 1951. How else can we account for his orchestral transcriptions of Bach and Handel, and even Brahms' G minor piano quartet, which he also made late in his life, in fact, later than that other G minor piece we were just playing? You see, he loved music with such passion that the magnetic pull of tonality could never lose its hold on him, never quite, and it conditioned his own music to a smaller or greater extent, even through the whole revolutionary development of his 12-tone method. And it seems somehow inevitable that the sense of tonality haunts his most beautiful works. Even when it's not demonstrably present, it still haunts those works by its conspicuous absence, if you can follow me. Does that sound paradoxical? It isn't at all when you realize that the 12 tones employed by Schoenberg are the same old 12 tones employed by everybody else, derived in the same way from the same natural harmonic series. They are the same 12 well-tempered tones of Bach, only their universal hierarchy has been destroyed, or at least an attempt has been made to destroy it. And Schoenberg himself was the first to recognize this all-important truth, and indeed the first to renounce the word atonality entirely, even to deny the possibility of atonality. Another paradox? Not at all. He knew, and we too must learn from him, that if ever a true atonality is to be achieved, some uniquely different basis for it must be found. The rules of the 12-tone method may be non-universal and even arbitrary, but not arbitrary enough to destroy the inherent tonal relationships among those 12 tones. Perhaps a real atonality can be achieved only artificially, through electronic means, perhaps, through a really arbitrary division of the octave space into something other than the 12 equidistant intervals of our chromatic scale. Let's say 13 equidistant intervals, or 30, or 313, but not 12, not the 12 tones of Bach and Beethoven and Wagner. With those 12 universals, neither Schoenberg, nor Berg, nor Webern, nor anyone could ever escape the nostalgic yearning for the deep structures implied by these notes, inherent in these notes. It's that alter Duft aus Märchenzeit again. And it's precisely this nostalgic yearning quality that so often makes their music beautiful and moving. Well, is there possibly the beginning of a clue here to the unanswered question? How does the wild thought strike you that all music is ultimately and basically tonal, even when it's non-tonal? Does this hypothetical notion touch off some innate response in you? I know it does in me. So it gives me the same sort of electric charge I always feel when any two facts intersect and spark an idea. And the two facts here are the two givens of one series intersecting another, the harmonic series and any given tone row series. And while we're on this subject of serial intersections, let's take a moment to remind ourselves that serial phenomena have been around for a long time, as far back, let's say, as the 13th century, in the use of cantus firmus, and even including some significant stabs at actual tone rows by, would you believe it, Bach, Mozart, and Beethoven. Here, for example, is the subject of Bach's F minor fugue from the first book of the well-tempered clavichord. Now, that extraordinarily chromatic subject encompasses 9 out of the 12 chromatic tones. That's 3/4 of all the notes we possess. And there's only one repetition in it, the first note. That one. All the others are different. But what's even more extraordinary is that in the course of the immediately ensuing fugal answer, Bach automatically picks up the 3 remaining tones. So that within these few bars, all 12 tones are present and accounted for. It's not a Schoenberg row, but it's remarkably close. And what about this spooky passage from Mozart's Don Giovanni? But all 12 notes are in there, all 12 of them, clear as day. And what about Beethoven's 9th? That sudden awestruck moment in the finale of recognizing the divine presence Wir stützen Mission. Hast du den Schöpfer Welt? Such nie Besterne Zell. Such nie Besterne Zell. Fantastic, that passage. And again, it's not Schoenberg, and admittedly, it presents only 11 notes out of the possible 12, but it is a row in the sense that for that brief duration, Beethoven suspends all tonal harmony, leaving only harmonic implications. That's what makes it so suddenly awesome, unrooted in earth, extraterrestrial. So that when earthly harmony does return, Brüder, that incandescent A major triad does indeed cry Brüder, universal brothers, all emerging together from that non-earthly divinity. I've strayed from Schoenberg, but not without intention. For in going back to Bach and Beethoven, we have had revealed to us a striking new ambiguity, which I was only suggesting earlier through the intersecting currents. Perhaps you can sense more strongly now what I meant by all music being tonal, even when it isn't. These early attempts at tone rows we've been hearing are clearly attempts to transcend tonality, to evoke mystery by momentarily denying or ignoring the universal roots of harmony which are born in the harmonic series. And this sudden rootlessness, however brief, in every case suggests the mystic, the unearthly, something unrooted in earth, whether it's Mozart's ghostly stone guest or Beethoven's evocation of the Godhead. What then happens to music when Schoenberg, for example, constructs a whole system based on that rootlessness? Does that system therefore make all his music and that of his followers unqualifiedly mystic, or only unqualifiedly intellectualized? What has happened to what Keats called the poetry of earth, which ceases never? Is Schoenberg an end or a beginning? These are some of the problems we'll be confronting in our next and final lecture.